Today we're going to wrap up a series of sermons that Todd's been going through on the book of James, and we're going to stop the very last part of James, as we mentioned last week, but it's in that last chapter, and it seemed like a fitting end from where the book began as well, and I appreciate the opportunity to share that with you today. We're going to begin this morning by looking at James chapter 5, reading verses 7 through 12. I did not look up the number of the page in the pew Bible, but there you also find it. So let's begin by reading James chapter 5, verses 7 through 12. It will also be on the screen. Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, patiently waiting for the autumn and spring rains. You too, be patient and stand firm, because the Lord's coming is near. Don't grumble against one another, brothers and sisters, or you will be judged. The judge is standing at the door. Brothers and sisters, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. As you know, we count as blessed those who have persevered. You have heard of Job's perseverance and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. Above all, my brothers and sisters, do not swear, not by heaven or by earth or by anything else. All you need to say is a simple yes or no. Otherwise, you will be condemned. Let's begin with a word of prayer. God, as we've read these words and as we've considered the words all throughout the book of James, help them to stir in our hearts actions that we need to take in our lives. We are confronted and convicted by the things that we read and how much sometimes our lives do not look like what you have described you desire from us. And so as we spend some time in this passage today thinking about what it means to be patient, to stand firm in the things that you have taught us to do, may these words of yours shape our lives and cause us to move in a new and better direction that can provide hope for people and a way towards the future instead of towards despair. Be with us in all of these things. Speak through your word and through the things that I'll share in a way that powerfully impacts all of us here today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Back in the 1930s, it was a tough time to be a farmer in America. And perhaps nowhere in the country was this more deeply felt than among those farmers living in the Great Plains. By 1935, the farmers living there in particular had been dealing with the consequences of an economic collapse from the Great Depression in the 20s that caused prices of their crops to be much reduced. Then a drought began in that area in 1931 that would last most of the decade. And regular dust storms caused by a year of overplowing and overgrazing the grasslands on the prairie. I need to do something different. Making a little bit of a sound there. Years of overplowing and overgrazing the grasslands of the prairie were causing these dust storms. And on April 14th, 1935, came a day like no other. A massive dust storm turned a sunny day completely dark for several hours under the pummeled areas of Colorado, New Mexico, Kansas, Texas, Oklahoma. It was so bad that it got a name. They called it Black Sunday, and it was one of the worst dust storms of that period. Some estimate that over 300,000 tons of topsoil was displaced, some of it reaching as far as the East Coast. And for many Dust Bowl farmers, Black Sunday was the last straw that finally led them to decide to just abandon their land, flee to other parts of the country. They had done all that they could to endure hardship after hardship related to their land from all those many years of dealing with the dust storms. Many of them had become sick from inhaling the dust. There was a sickness that developed from that. They were out of work, many of them. Many of them were hungry, suffering daily. And so some of them understandably lost hope in that that situation was ever going to improve. And they decided that for themselves and for their loved ones, it was time to leave. And so many of them packed up, decided to take their chances starting over somewhere else. And many of us wouldn't blame them. That would look to be a wise decision, because it wasn't for another 4 or 5 years, in 1939, that the first rains began to return to the Great Plains, and things finally began to improve for those still living there. But that's what's really amazing to me, is that people were still living there. Despite all the harsh conditions, actually the majority of the farming families that lived in those places at that time stayed, and they patiently endured the terrible circumstances of those years. And so I think when we come to this passage in James, we read these words at the end of chapter 5, encouraging the church to be patient and to stand firm in the face of suffering. We're reminded that we're not without some modern examples of people who have done just that through some very severe physical conditions. But James also gives us some important examples to consider. And we're going to look at those today as we look at conclude the study of this book. These examples can inspire us to endure not just the physical challenges that we might face in our life, but also spiritual ones, which sometimes are more difficult. And here in the middle of chapter 5 of James, he urges God's people in this way. He says, "Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming." An interesting thing I learned in studying for this message, so the Greek word is translated patient here, which I'm not going to attempt to pronounce. It's an interesting one. There's several different words and thoughts behind the different words for patience. But this one here is more than the idea of endlessly passing time in a doctor's office waiting room, which you've maybe heard the joke that that's why they call us patients, because that's what you spend most of your time doing at the doctor's office. It's also slightly different from the word that was used in chapter 1 of James, when he talks about patience through trials of many kinds, if you remember back to that message. There, it's referring to bearing up under difficult circumstances, maybe referring more to physical challenges like poverty or hunger or health issues, where there might be this expectation of relief in the near future, and it has more to do with physical circumstances. But here in chapter 5, this is the word that is translated long-suffering. And there seems to also be a reference in this word that whenever it's used, it's often used in connection with enduring people, difficult people, who oppose and perhaps provoke or torment or bully us over and over and over again, to the point that just drives you crazy. When I was younger, my long suffering probably came at the hands of my sister, who would take joy in finding new ways to irritate me. And I think she would say her long suffering came at my hands. We had that kind of relationship for a few years. We're close now, but brothers and sisters do that, and then you kind of grow out of that, and we're close now. But there are some people where that behavior never ends, right? We've come across some people in our life that seem to just take joy in finding new ways to push you towards the edge. And it can lead to a lot of damage in our lives and the lives of others. It can lead us to some very dark places, and it can lead us to make some bad choices in how we treat people. But the encouragement of James in this passage is that in those times in particular, we need to restrain ourselves from the natural impulse towards vigilante justice. We have a lot of superheroes that I think embody that desire that we have inside to take things into our own hands. We have to restrain ourselves from an anger-driven response, even when it's an obvious wrong or an offense against ourselves or even against other people. And I think the reason that he gives us this reminder, this is sort of a reason that there's also this reminder in there about the Lord is coming, that God is coming. It's because when we look at a situation and we face something difficult, we feel like nobody's going to do anything about it. Nothing is going to make this wrong right. Then that's when we feel some need or some responsibility to do something. But if the Lord is coming, then we can wait and be patient and stand firm. Here's what it says in Romans chapter 12, verse 19. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. This is not always the message we want to hear, because there are times when we get tired of feeling like a punching bag. We have these moments where we want to stand up and fight and destroy evil people and their evil ways. Even if violence is required to do that, we suddenly think, well, we can just be violent and do what we need to do. But this is not the way of Jesus, and in fact, we see in Jesus' life, in the face of extreme injustices against himself, rather than using his power to punish those people and do it justly, he patiently endured, and he waited for God's plan to play out. This, James said, should be our way as well, to patiently endure hard times, even at great personal cost. That's not because we're afraid to do anything or because we're apathetic about justice taking place, but it's because our faith is in God's sovereignty and we know that he will handle it better than we can. So what does it look like for us to be patient and stand firm through our conflicts with others? For the rest of this morning's message, I'd like to just briefly look at the three examples that James shares as role models, in a sense, of what it looks like to be patient and stand firm even when things are difficult. He also mentions three warnings that we'll also look at just briefly at the end. So the very first example we have of this that he gives is a farmer. Okay, so think of any farmers that you might know, or if you've spent some time in farming, maybe you can go back to those days. I have a lot of respect and appreciation for farmers, but I'm quick to admit that I'm a city boy. I grew up in a city. I don't have a lot of firsthand experience with what it's like to live on a farm, to raise animals or raise crops, do all the things that go on with that. But thankfully, I do know a few people who've had some of that experience, one of which is our children's minister, Rob Meyer. So I picked Rob's brain a little bit earlier this week, and I asked him if he had any great insights or stories about his time as a farm boy growing up in rural Indiana. And just to kind of see, you know, what was that like to live in that life? And he said one of the things that he remembered relating to patience as a farmer was that his dad had several areas of land throughout their property that they just had to leave it alone. Sometimes for up to like 10 years, they would just leave it alone. They would just set it aside and not touch it. And this was something that was learned through the experiences of the Dust Bowl, that you can't work the land every year. You have to live it some natural time to rejuvenate itself. And so that was one thing that was probably very frustrating at times, that, you know, if you need to make a little bit of extra money or have a little bit more, you have this empty land doing nothing, but it's doing nothing for a purpose. He also remembered that something related to what it says in there about waiting for the rains. But in contrast to waiting for rains in a drought situation, like the Dust Bowl, he said what they had to do was wait for the rain to stop. At a certain point, you know, they would have so much rain that the fields would get soggy. It would throw off the moisture content of their crops if it was there and it was kind of a flood situation. So they were waiting for the rain, but for a different reason. And a lot of farming is very much a waiting game. You agree with that. So if you want to know more about farming, Rob might be a good person to talk to. You all, probably everybody in the room might know. But this is what we do know from what James says as well. We can agree that there's a lot of patience involved in it. And James says in the rest of verse 7 and 8, see how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, patiently waiting for the autumn and spring rains. You too be patient and stand firm, because the Lord's coming is near. And this, I think, is an object lesson that wouldn't have been lost on those who first read these words of James, because they lived in a much more agricultural society. They didn't get their food from grocery stores. It came from, you know, their farmer neighbors were growing their food that they needed in many cases. And basically, the ones that were working as farmers were being depended upon by their whole local community to be successful. And there was probably a lot of times when it was, you know, is it ready yet? Is your crop ready yet? That was probably a regular conversation that maybe got frustrating for farmers as they were waiting as well, because they had done all the work up front and they had to kind of patiently wait to see the results of that. They were eagerly expecting something good to come later, but they had to put in the hard work first and go through some suffering and some turmoil, just with the hope that there would be a payoff in the end of that. And I think that's a much different mindset than what we think of in our modern society today. We think in terms of we've got to go get what we want, and we've got to get it right now, even if we don't have the money for it, and we're going to borrow that money and pay it back even higher later, and go into debt for it. And maybe one of the best recent examples of that is this past week, the latest and greatest iPhone was announced. If you hadn't heard, the iPhone X will be available in October for the low price of $999. And so I'm sure that there will be some people that don't really have the money for that, but they'll be waiting in line, camping out a couple nights maybe in front of an Apple store, to be among the first to have the new phone, let's say check their phone that they bought last year for $800 or whatever that was. But maybe it's not with iPhones with you, and I'm not, if you want an iPhone, that's fine. But it's an example of what happens in our culture when everybody wants the newest, the best thing, at any cost. A throwaway, perfectly good thing that we do have, to get something that's just a little bit more shiny, a little bit faster, a little bit better by whatever criteria you use to measure that. And maybe for us, it's not with iPhones, but there's many, many areas in all of our lives when we want what we want, and we want it now. We don't want to wait. We don't want to put in work and wait and see and hope. We want to take control and have the best that we can have at this moment, even if it costs us in the end. And James reminds us that even in important matters, there's things like justice, that we are called to be patient and to stand firm and not take things into our own hands and seek immediate justice in the way that we think it should happen. Something good will come at the end of all of our current struggles if we wait and let God's plan play out. Another way that he points to another example has to do with the prophets. So we're going to be, I think, talking about prophets soon. I think that's our upcoming sermon series. We'll be learning about several of the prophets. But listen to what James says here in verses 10 and 11. Brothers and sisters, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. As you know, we consider blessed those who have persevered. Some of the prophets that I tend to think about first, that you may already be pretty familiar with, are a lot of the major prophets. We've got Isaiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, Jeremiah. There's several others that we'll learn about and probably think about as well. But of all of those, I think the one that most immediately stands out to me in connection with suffering is Jeremiah. So maybe you're familiar with Jeremiah. This is actually a Rembrandt painting of Jeremiah, a bit of a Rembrandt painting of artwork. But he stands out to me as the one that we most associate with suffering because he's often called the weeping prophet. He witnessed some of the darkest days in Israel's history as God's people were captured, taken into captivity by the evil nation of Babylon. And as if that wasn't bad enough, he was called to share sort of a message of, here's why this is happening from God to God's people. And as you can imagine, they didn't take it very well. He was largely rejected by his own people. He was threatened by his own people. Jeremiah loved them. He wanted to call them to repentance, let them see their mistakes so that things could improve. But he got to kind of witness the evil that God was judging them for and their response to him. They didn't like what God was saying to them through him, and thereby they didn't like him because he was faithful in sharing God's message. And I think that's one reason I find it really ironic that a lot of our modern, what we might call prosperity preachers, they really like to quote Jeremiah 29:11. Maybe you've heard this before, but they do it completely out of context of suffering. And for probably the opposite reason that God has that verse in there for us to learn from. And this is what the verse says just in 29:11. I'm sure you've heard it before. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and to not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. And I've heard this many times shared in a way that leaves out a lot of the story that surrounds it. And too often it just kind of shares, God wants everything to be perfect for you. If you'll just come and you'll just give us your money and you'll just come do all the things we say to do, everything will be fixed in your life. And I don't think that's truly what the gospel is. Becoming a Christian doesn't suddenly fix everything and make everything easy. In fact, we've got a lot of reasons to think it adds some challenges to our life, the challenges that are worth it. And here's what it says in the broader view, if you look at the full context of 29, including verses 10 through 14. It says, this is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. Now, if I'm somebody living through those times, that doesn't sound like the most encouraging message from God, that my next 70 years are going to be very enjoyable because they're about to go into captivity. They're not going to be immediately rescued. But God does give some hope and say that there is a purpose for this, and there is a plan, and there is something on the other side of that. And I think that's the main thing that he wants us to gain from that, is that we may have some difficult circumstances to face, but there's a purpose for it, and it's worth standing up under. It's worth enduring. To follow God faithfully, there's no guarantee that life on this earth is going to be comfortable or prosperous or even reasonably fair. So that even if you do everything perfectly right in God's eyes, that's not the way that the fallen world works. It's not balanced in that way. But that's the eternal life we look forward to when God reconciles all things. And it's something that will eventually come about through his judgment. But in this life, what we're called to do is just endure suffering patiently, as the prophets of old did. There's another thing Jesus says in John 15, 18 through 21, a passage I'm sure we've all heard before as well. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. And as it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Remember what I told you. A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours also. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they do not know the one who sent me. Final example this morning is Job. And here's what it says in verse 11 about him. You have heard of Job's perseverance and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. I really love the story of Job for a few reasons. We're currently 3 weeks into a Bible study with our youth on Sunday mornings about the book of Job. And I was really tempted to spend maybe the entire sermon just pulling out that verse and just talking about Job. Because there's so many amazing things about his story. It seems to be in the very extreme end of what God might ever call a righteous person to do. Terms of enduring suffering for a purpose that he had in mind that Job didn't understand and maybe never would until much later. Job is one of these guys, if he showed up in church today, we both love him and hate him. we would obviously see the righteousness in his life and look up to that, but there'd be the, you know, He'd be embarrassing us at every corner, maybe, if he lives up to this description that God himself gives to him. That God says at the very beginning, not that he's a perfect man, but he brags about Job to Satan. And God brags about Job and says, there's no one on earth like him. He's blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil. And so you know that that must be a pretty special person. I'd love for God to say that about me. I'm not sure he could. But Job was a blessed man. He had a great family, great wealth, a great name among all people. And then all of a sudden, he wasn't. He didn't have those things. All those things were taken away from him. His whole family died at once, except his wife. He lost all of his wealth all at once. He became someone who was pitied instead of revered. And even his closest friends assumed the worst about him, that all, instead of this being just something that God was doing or some test, they didn't see that. They just thought, man, Job, what have you been doing in secret to bring all this trouble upon yourself? And the vast majority of the book of Job is this miserable journey through his suffering. And all the conversations that he has with his friends. But it's not about, punishment. It's about Job proving himself by being willing to endure those things. And the power of what that could hold when we are patient and we stand firm and we do not sin against God. We do not speak a word against him. I believe that God, in the life of Job, had hope that Job's faithfulness and his willingness to endure patiently was something that might minister to and have an effect on Satan. I really believe that that's how powerful our patience and endurance through suffering can be. But the thing that James says we're meant to hold on to most dearly from Job's life is that the Lord is full of compassion and mercy. We can't ever lose hope that God is going to one day right every wrong in our lives. We need to, trust him and let God be the one that handles any of the things that go wrong in our life and handles any of the wicked people that confront us. And our job is just to be patient, to stand firm in Christ, the Christ who is called the suffering servant, who was silent before his accusers, didn't use all of his available power to destroy those around him, but instead, even from the cross, he loved them and asked for their forgiveness. Final couple words of the warnings that we see at the end of this book, or kind of throughout this passage here that we're looking at, leads us to this question of whether or not we treat other people with the same compassion and mercy that God has shown to us. James shares these three things to cause us to question that, and ways that we can improve our patience through suffering. First, he says in verse 9, do not grumble against each other. And he says in verse 12, do not swear by heaven, earth, or anything else. And finally, he says, the judge is standing at the door. I think we could look at all of those statements individually in a lot more detail, but I just want to share for just a moment here that a few words that's kind of the point of all of them. When we grumble against each other, when we swear by heaven, earth, or anything else, when we forget that the judge, God, is near and standing at the door, ready to make the wrongs right, we're essentially doing the same thing. We're placing ourselves and our limited power above God and his work, his perfect power, to do things the right way. We're going to mess it up. We're going to get it wrong, and we do it a lot. Grumbling and complaining about other people and things that we don't like about them, that doesn't accomplish anything good. We might have this temporary feeling that we're somehow a better person than that person by pointing out how wrong they are and how much we don't like them. But how would you feel if another person did that to you, constantly pointed out your flaws and complained about you? You'd feel like that was suffering against us. Even if there's a legitimate problem with the person, you're not the righteous judge who can speak the truth in love. You don't have the authority to cast the ultimate judgment on them. Likewise, I think it's a mistake for us to sometimes add extra emphasis to something we say, especially when we invoke God, in order to make it seem like our promises are anything like his, as if we're as trustworthy as God is. James just says it's enough, so just let your yes be your yes, your no be your no, because when you invoke God, which can happen in a time of suffering, and you want to, make a deal with God, or you want to put a special emphasis on somebody, as God is my witness, you're going down, or we might go to a place like that that's beyond what we're supposed to do. If we're not careful to do everything that we say or do when we bring God into that, we are casting some trouble on ourselves by bringing in his name. I've only been in a courtroom a few times. I can tell you that for those directly involved in a court case, it's not exactly a relaxing experience. I'm not sure, I'd say, I'm sure most judges are probably pretty nice people in their everyday lives, but when you enter their courtroom, whatever capacity, it becomes very clear very fast that you're dealing with an authority that you must have a lot of respect for. And this is especially true at this moment that I think that I calls my attention to when I read that verse in verse 9 where the judge is standing at the door. When the judge is at the door and the bailiff says, "All rise, court is now in session, the honorable judge is presiding," that is this moment that you know, like, I better watch what I say, I better watch what I do. There are serious consequences here, and I'm dealing with somebody that may have the facts in front of me. And in verse 9, when James says God is standing at the door, that fact is either going to terrify us or relieve us based on whether we're guilty or we're innocent. If we're doing these things that we're being called to do, if we're being patient, then that is the moment of our justice, of our relief from the oppression that we felt. If we are among the ones that are causing the suffering of others by losing our temper, by everybody going to doing things that we've never been called to do by God, we're going to have to answer for those things at that moment. But I hope that when we hear that the judge is standing near the door, that is our cause for hope. That is the thing we're going to hold on to. Let's not join the wicked when we're persecuted by responding to them with wickedness that lacks faith in God's justice. If we do that, we only make ourselves guilty with them. Instead, we need to be brave, willing to follow the ways of Jesus, the Prince of Peace, the suffering servant, whose strength was displayed in his willingness to be humble and broken for our sake.